AEW New Japan Forbidden Door is less than 3 weeks away, and Blood and Guts is about 6 weeks away. But before that, let's talk about this show. I'm Charles Rankin with my review of AEW Dynamite from the Wells Fargo Arena in Des Moines, Iowa. I know it's Des Moines, Iowa. Work with me here. Trying to have fun. Let me know your thoughts on this show in the comments, please. And yes, this particular review up earlier than normal because I was able to watch this show live. And oh boy, what a show it was. So, they had around 3,000 people according to WrestleTix or thereabouts. Unfortunately, the Wells Fargo Arena, the capacity is significantly higher than that. I understand buildings can't always be filled, but don't run NBA-sized arenas if you don't promote and market yourselves well. That being said, let's just get into it. So, Swerve is out here to swerve when he drives to talk about Will Ospreay, somebody that he respects, but does he have that killer instinct? Oscut Breaker! So anyway, yeah, Swerve refers to himself as being, you know, called Kill Shot for a reason. Shrieking Lucha Underground noises. Ring the bell! I miss that guy. I really miss that guy. I nearly called him Dario Argento, and I'm like, no, that's not right. Maybe he's Dario Sargento. Sargento Cheese. Boy, those guys were goddamn creepy. But he says, if you don't pull the trigger, I will. And then Chris Adams, well, never mind. So, basically he took shots at the Bucks. Then the Elite show up, the Joke World Order. I mean, you could come up with a number of names. I don't want to see Okada anymore. They have just completely ruined Okada. Not about him being a heel. He can be a heel. Actually, I would argue he's a better heel than he is a face. But goddamn, this is terrible. So, the Bucks basically say, you know, half the roster is gone because of us. That is not the positive thing that you think it is. Because, yeah, half the roster is gone. Many have moved on to greener pastures. And even if they can't stay healthy, they still mean a hell of a lot more than you ever had to this fucking company. So, Blood and Guts Challenge, which apparently will be on July 24th in Nashville, Tennessee. I have nothing against Nashville, I just felt like saying that. So, Swerve, will you be our fifth man? Swerve doesn't take the sneakers off her. Nana throws them in the goddamn crowd, which is actually pretty smooth. Those are hideous goddamn sneakers. But whatever, good on the Bucks for getting more money they never fucking earned. And, yeah, Swerve refers to pearl necklaces. And then the Bucks basically say, an injury bug is floating around. It just landed on you. Because we're all unsafe douchebags and we don't know how to fucking work and we keep getting injured. There are more people in the goddamn injured list or sitting at home collecting a paycheck than there are on these goddamn programs. It's actually a fucking miracle. So, Daniels comes out. Christopher Daniels, the EVP mouthpiece for Tony Khan. You thought the Millionaires Club New Blood storyline was terrible. So, basically, here's the first match. It's Dustin Rhodes against the scapegoat, Jack Perry. Let me just say that the stuff with Jack Perry's not working. He has really not improved all that much in five goddamn years. If anything, he's regressed. Dustin and Jack Perry look at a TNT ladder match, qualifying match. Dustin was bleeding a little bit, into the match. And then there was some exposed concrete spots. At one point, there was a crossroads for two. A DDT on the concrete where Jack Perry, I think, smacked his back harder. Good job there, you fucking idiot. He had a flash knee. 1, 2, 3. Jack Perry won. I'm not shocked by that. It's just not going to make me interested in him. And then Renee talks to the faces of the six-man. Also, Willow Nightingale was there. Kyle O'Reilly, please don't have him cut promos. Mark Briscoe was certainly fired up, and yeah, the other guy was there. Roosh took on Dion Rushman, or Rushman. Basically, Rush tossed him around and beat him. Then calls out MJF. Then MJF comes out, and Indy Security, despite being in Iowa, gets beat up. And they go into the crowd. I thought they did this last week, except now they just expanded the whole thing. Next week, they're going to go on the goddamn roof for their match. Hopefully not. The Roosh on roof. The Roosh is on fire. Oh, no. We're not in Kansas City, fortunately. So, we go to the back. A table bump. It's a shame that Rick Knox wasn't put through it. MJF and Rush is going to be happening next week to open the show completely ad-free. Okay, nice little way to hook people there. No, not hook. We'll get to him in a bit. You know what? Okay, they actually acted like a real wrestling promotion for a little bit because MJF was involved. And I have a feeling this is probably the highlight of the show as far as the spike in ratings because MJF is going to have to basically carry this show because they are doing no favors for anybody. Even though Swerve, I think, is going to be involved in the whole blood and guts thing. And yeah, last week we got to see how Joe and Hook beat up Neith, Sterling, and Ari Daivari while Shibata and his new brain filmed them. And then Cassidy, O'Reilly, and Briscoe took on Takeshita, Fletcher, and Strong with Trent. Trent, who now is happy that likes are no longer visible on Twitter, so he can like all the racist, bigoted, and sexist shit that he wants. A Jordan Peterson, dick-sucking son of a bitch. But then again, to be perfectly honest, when his mother is more over than him, when his mother's minivan is more over than he ever could be, I guess now he's thrilled by that. That being said, Trent has never really been all that good, so at least he wasn't in this match. Unfortunately, I didn't give a shit about this because Orange Cassidy is involved. I don't really care about Fletcher. I don't really care about Strong. I like Takeshita. O'Reilly doesn't mean anything to me. And Mark Briscoe is the Ring of Honor champion, so naturally, he takes the pin. Yay! Willow music hits, but Statlander is repeatedly establishing her dominance. Nevertheless, Stokely takes a picture. I'm amazed he could get such a good shot or whatever, because even with Willow and Statlander basically on the ground, Stokely still was barely above their knees. But there you go. So, good. Hey, they're building Statlander and Willow. I'll give them credit for that. I wouldn't be surprised if they tried to do a woman's blood and guts. They might actually do that. They could actually do just an entire blood and guts show. Watch them do that. So anyway, Renee is backstage with Phoenix, and she basically says, oh, Phoenix earlier today told me all this stuff and everything. Well, Phoenix is back there. I know English is a second language. He can cut at least a halfway decent promo, you know, even with broken English. But we didn't want to trust him to do that. So he's just working out while Renee talks about stuff that we didn't get to see Phoenix say. Shingo Takagi is going to be part of the Owen Hart tournament. Okay, he'll probably be out in the next couple weeks, only because the G1 is starting mid-July, I think. Daniels is then backstage and says the Elite will be in eliminator matches. It'll be Okada, or I don't know who Okada's facing if they announce it, I didn't care. It will be the Bucks against the Acclaimed. And all seconds are banned from ringside. Can they ban Rick Knox from ringside? Can they ban Rick Knox from ruining refereeing? So, now Shibata and his new brain are filming Joe and Hook as they go to the ring and they beat Ari Daivari and Tony Nese, who still work there. Sterling gets choked up by Shibata and his new brain. Let's never forget that Dave Meltzer said that. That is why Meltzer deserves to be mocked. And Stephanie Valcour. She's La Primera. I think she's neat. God, does she look good. And her and Mercedes ought to have a decent match. Speaking of Mercedes, here's Mercedes, the CEO against Zooksies, who I don't know anything about. I have nothing against her, except get better gear, because if she had hopped even a little bit, you know, too hard, they would have, you know, given her two black eyes. Some CEO chants. Look, they worked hard. I don't think that this was necessarily an egregiously terrible match. I just don't think it was great. She did tear up a kid sign at one point. Zooksies did, that is. And Mercedes won. She needs a new finisher. She really needs a new finisher. I've seen worse matches, but this still wasn't great. Let's fly through and talk about Mina Shirakawa. Boy, would I like to. A package where she is just showing off how great she looks. And she's got energy and she is adorable. And she actually does back it up in the ring. So you know what? Good on her. I still can't believe she's in her mid-30s because she doesn't look like it. So then we cut to Tony petting Mariah May while she's in her bosom. Tony will face Alex Windsor, who I believe was part of a recent New Japan US show or a couple of them. And there we are. So, okay, that's the women's stuff for the night. The Learning Tree segment with Jericho, the stupid Redwood Tree, you know, Big Bill, and also Private Party, who ended up basically laying out everybody. Brian Keith was also there. I don't care how good he is in the ring. I'm not going to pay attention to anything Brian Keith is involved in because this is not going to do anything for him. This isn't the right kind of trolling. It basically just shows that Jericho has a fragile ego and knows that he is not doing anything good, and none of this is working. It's not working at all. There are some people that like it. Some of y'all are even allowed outside without adult supervision, and some of y'all are mutuals, and I appreciate you guys. But, yeah, let's just be perfectly honest. Unless Jericho wants to address where his wife was on January 6, 2021, and talk about all the bad shit that he has going on in his life, I really don't need to see anything involving him. So, yeah, Private Party laid out Jericho, and I think it was Cassidy that hit, like, the safest goddamn swanton where he took most of the force. So, the Gangbang Gang, the Juice Guns, they're backstage. They want the House of Black. They tease the lights off thing, and that's going to happen on Collision. Daniel Garcia took on Nick Camarado, who is shaved, and I thought it was Billy Jack Haynes. Somebody thought it was Iron Mike Sharp. I think Camarado's career is alive and well. I mean, maybe not, because he lost pretty quickly. And the guy looks good. I just don't know where the hell he's been. Yeah, DDT, and then Ospreay is waiting to face off against Phoenix, but he knows Daniel Garcia is coming for him. Lol. There's an elf! Oh, it's Pac. And he talks about being angry and wanting to attack people and being in the Owen Hart Cup tournament. So you're going to have a man and a woman winning. So once again, for the third year in a row, it's going to be two winners, one Owen Cup. Have fun unseeing that. So Ospreay hands an envelope to Swerve. Something about the contract, I guess, for the match. Probably going to have a contract signed next week. Ospreay and Phoenix had a highly athletic match where they kept spamming special moves, special moves, special moves. And they just did their stuff. I'm not complaining as far as the crowd energy. I mean, they kept it going, but they did the cool spot where Phoenix hit the Rana, Ospreay landed on his feet, and then they did the same thing where Phoenix landed on his feet. We had a 6-minute overrun. They did this thing where there was a stomp that was teased by Ospreay, but they kept zooming the camera back and forth, like such unprofessional production values. And then the stomp and the hidden blade, the whiffing blade, because he whiffed it. 1, 2, 3. And then a face off the Swerve, and Swerve basically says, you know, you're good, but you're not strong enough to hold both these worlds on your shoulders. And or on both your shoulders. And then Ospreay takes the title and is holding them. We're getting his face off. I think Swerve's losing at Forbidden Door. So yeah, that's a great title run that he's had. Because I don't know how the hell they get out of this. Because Swerve's going to be part of Blood and Guts. And I think they need the title off of him. But yeah, there you go. That's your Dynamite review. I'm going to be back to working normal shifts. Or my normal shifts. So I'll have those reviews on delay. And I think I got like one other upcoming day, I think in like a Wednesday in like a month, where I'll be able to watch it live. So hopefully it's a better show than this, even though there were moments that still wasn't that great. Agree, disagree, what I said, like, share, subscribe, Twitter handle in the description. I'm John Ritland. I'll see you soon.